Brothers in Islam, the best advice a Muslim can give his brothers and sisters is the advice to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's narrated in hadith in Al-Adab Al-Mufrid by Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah, that once a man went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking him to show him deeds that would be a reason for him to go to Jannah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of all the deeds, out of all the acts of worship, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed him to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to have good character. Taqwallah and husnul khuluq. Taqwallah, to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by implementing the teachings of the Quran and the teachings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and staying away from what's prohibited in the Quran and what's prohibited on the tongue of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after that comes husnul khuluq, to have good character. Brothers in Islam, brothers and sisters in Islam, there is a deed, there is a sin, that if it spreads in any society, there's a sin that if it spreads in any society, then that sin can be the destruction for that society. There is a sin that if it's widespread and the Muslims practice it until it becomes a daily practice and it sets firm into that society, and it sets firm to such an extent where they feel that it's not wrong, this sin that's practiced can be a reason for that society to be destroyed. Brothers and sisters in Islam, this is the sin of bribery. This is a sin of bribery. Bribery is a sin that spreads abuse. Bribery is a sin that corrupts the character of a Muslim. Bribery is a sin that spreads hatred and animosity and laziness within the Muslims. Bribery takes away the rights of people. And any society where bribery is widespread, that society will be destroyed unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy on them and he shows them the truth. He shows them the way of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So much so that in a hadith, an authentic hadith by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الرَّاشِيَ وَالْمُرْتَشِي, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has cursed the one that takes bribery. He has cursed the one that bribes. And he has cursed the one that gives bribes. The one that gives the bribe, he is cursed. The one that takes the bribe, he is cursed. And brothers and sisters in Islam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he curses a person for his actions, this shows that it's a grave sin, it's a major sin, like how the scholars have mentioned in the books when they talk about sin. That person that bribes, that person that takes bribes, he is cursed. And when someone is cursed, they are deprived from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when they are deprived from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how does that person accept? How does he expect to be successful? But if a Muslim wants to stay away from bribery, if he understands the first hadith If he understands that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has cursed the one that takes bribery and the one that gives it. What is bribery? A Muslim should know evil if he is to stay away from it. And how the scholars define it, bribery is money or a benefit that's given to a ruler or a leader or an employee working in an organization in order to make something wrong right and to make something right wrong. This is how the scholars define bribery. Bribery is money or a gift or some sort of benefit that is given to a ruler or a king or an employee in order to make something right wrong or to make something wrong right. This is bribery. The people that bribe, they eat money that's corrupted. They eat money that's evil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Al-Baqarah, وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. Do not eat the property of one another in wrong. وَتُدْلُوا بِهَا إِلَى الْحُكَّامِ لِتَأْكُلُوا فَرِيقًا مِّنْ أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ بِالْإِثْمِ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. And know, do not eat the property of one another in wrong, and nor give bribery to the rulers. For if you do that, you are eating the property of one another sinfully. And eating what's wrong is in contrast to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advised the best men to walk on the face of this earth. In a hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبْ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is pure. He accepts nothing except that thing that is pure. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ بِمَا أَمَرَ بِهِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the people of belief, the people of iman, just like how He commanded the messengers that He sent to these nations. Just like how He commanded the messengers that He sent to the different nations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, Ya ayyuha ar-rusul, kulu min tayyibati wa'malu saliha. O messengers, eat from that which is pure. Eat from that which is clean. Eat from that which is not contaminated. وَأَعْمَلُوا صَالِحًا. And do good deeds. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُلُوا مِن طَيِّبَاتِ مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. O you who believe, eat from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Eat from that because it's halal. When a person is conscious over what goes in his belly, when a person is worried and he knows exact and he's conscious and he's fearful and he's always on the alert on looking at what goes in his tummy, that person has a chance for his ibadat to be accepted. In Sahih Muslim, once the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he described the likeliness of a man who goes on a journey. The authentic hadith in Sahih Muslim. This man goes on a journey and he becomes tired, exhausted, to such an extent where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, Ash'ath Aghbar. That he becomes full of dust and you can see that he's tired and he's on a journey. And when someone is on a journey, when someone is a traveler, this is one of the reasons. It's one of the reasons where the scholars, they say your dua is more likely to be accepted when you're on a, when you're traveling, when you're on a journey. So this man, he's on a journey and he's weak, and he puts his hands, he puts them to the skies and he says, Ya Rabb, Ya Rabb. And the Prophet ﷺ says, Mat'amu haram, malbasuhu haram, mashrabuhu haram, wa ghudhiya bil haram, anna yustajabu li dhalik. This man, he puts his hands to the sky saying, Ya Rabb, Ya Rabb. Oh Allah, oh Allah. His clothes that he wears, they haram. What he drinks is haram. What he eats is haram. Anna yustajabu li dhalik. How does this person expect for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to answer his dua? How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept for, how does he accept for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept his dua? And brothers and sisters in Islam, changing the name of bribery, changing it to, no matter how many ways you define it, no matter how many ways you define bribery, it doesn't change the reality that it is a sin that is cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the people that take bribery, they eat from what's not pure. In Sahih Muslim, once the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he sent a man from the Al-Asad tribe to go and collect zakah from the Muslims. When the man returned, he came to the Prophet ﷺ and says, هَذَا لَكُمْ وَهَذَا أُهْدِيَ إِلَيَّ. He says, this is for you. This was given as a gift for me. So the Prophet ﷺ sends this man. He gives him a duty. He gives him a responsibility. He sends him out to the villages to collect the zakat. This is a job. So the man comes back and he says, Ya Rasulullah, this is what I've collected. And this here, this is a gift that was given to me. So the Prophet ﷺ stood on the pulpit. He stood on the minbar. فَحَمِدَ اللَّهُ وَأَثْنَى عَلَيْهِ. He praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and glorified him. And then he says, what is the matter of a man? I send him to do a job. He comes back and he tells me, this is for you and this is a gift from me. How dare a man, I send him for a job. He goes, he does his job, he comes back. He says, this is for you and this is for me. Then the Prophet ﷺ says, أَفَلَا قَعَدَ فِي بَيْتِ أَبِيهِ أَفَلَا قَعَدَ فِي بَيْتِ أُمِّهِ فَيَنْظُرْ أَيُهْدَى إِلَيْهِ أَمْ لَا. Should this man not have sat in the house of his father or sat in the house of his mother to see if people would have given him a hadiyah? Should this man who took this gift, because he was given a job, he was given a job to collect the zakat, and then he took a gift for the job that he did. Should this man had not sat in his father's house or his mother's house and seen if he would have got this hadiyah? Then the Prophet ﷺ says, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ. I swear in the soul, in the hand who holds the soul of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. مَا يَنَالُ أَحَدٌ مِنْكُمْ مِنْهَا شَيْئًا. There's not a person that takes a part of this gift or this gift إِلَّا أَتَى يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, except he will come on the day of judgment. وَهُوَ يَحْمِلُ عَلَىٰ عُنُقِهِ, and he will hold on his neck بَقَرَةٌ أَوْ شَاتٌ, he will hold on his neck a cow or a camel. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he raised his hands and he says, oh Allah, have I not preached your religion? Have I not taught it to the people? He said it twice. Imam Nawawi, after this hadith, he said, this is clear evidence that people that take gifts for doing a job that they get paid to do. Because when a person has a job, he takes a salary at the end of the month. He takes a salary at the end of the month. And on top of that, he does his duties and his responsibilities, and he gets gifts from people, from the public. Imam Nawawi says that this is clear evidence that it's not allowed to give an employee a gift for doing a duty or a responsibility that he gets paid to do. Except on the day of Qiyamah, he will stand in front of Allah and he will hold his gift on his neck. But it's very important to note that this hadith does not contradict the practice, the good practice of a management in an organization motivating their employees and them giving employees gifts in order for employees to work hard, to walk that extra mile, to exert that extra effort that they have. This doesn't come under this ruling. This ruling applies to people that take a salary for doing duties and responsibilities, and they don't do their duties and their responsibilities because the person hasn't given them a gift. We have received the month of Muharram. The month of Muharram is the first month in the Islamic calendar. It's one of those months that are sacred to such an extent where the people in the time of Jahiliyyah, they would respect some of the months in the Islamic calendar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ عِدَّةَ شُهُورٍ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ إِثْنَا عَشْرَ شَهْرًا فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ مِنْهَا أَرْبَعَةٌ حُرُمٌ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created 12 months in the year. From these 12 months, 4 are hurum, 4 are sacred. To such an extent, the people of Jahiliyyah, they would respect this month. And when these 4 months, and one of them is Muharram, when these 4 months would come, they would stop fighting one another. They would stop shedding blood. And they would wait to do their abuse after these 4 months. They would wait to do their abuse after these 4 months. And when the month of Muharram came, with regards to the month of Muharram, there are two sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the month of Muharram. The first sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the hadith, أَفْضَلُ الصِّيَامِ بَعْدَ رَمَضَانِ شَهْرُ اللَّهِ الْمُحَرَّمِ. The best fast after Ramadan is the fast of Muharram. In Sahih Muslim, the best fast, the best optional fast after Ramadan is the month of Muharram. But it's important to note that it hasn't been narrated or reported in a hadith that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he fasted an entire month except Ramadan. It hasn't been narrated or reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam fasted a month completely except Ramadan. And the second sunnah of Muharram is to fast the 10th of Muharram. Imam Bukhari narrates in his Sahih that once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he came to Medina, he saw the Jews fasting. So he asked them, why do you fast? Why do you fast on this day? So they said, this is a great day. Yawmun Azeem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to Musa alayhi salam over Fir'aun. So we fast it, showing gratefulness, showing thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So upon hearing this, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَنَا أَحَقُّ بِمُوسَى مِنْكُمْ. Or in another narration, أَنَا أَوْلَى بِمُوسَى مِنْكُمْ. That I have more right to the respect of Musa than you Jews. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he fasted the 10th of Muharram, and he called his companions to fast. He called his companions to fast, like the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, فَصَامَهُ وَأَمَرَ النَّاسَ بِصِيَامِهِ. So he fasted, and he commanded his companions to fast it, to fast the 10th of Muharram. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was always anxious. He was always eager to make his worship stand out from the worship of Ahl Kitab, from the worship of the people of the scriptures, or the worship of people of disbelief. He would always like to stand out. He would always like to make his worship different. He wouldn't like to resemble his worship to the worship of the people of the scriptures or the people of disbelief in any way whatsoever. And he said, لَإِن بَقِيتُ إِلَىٰ قَابِلْ لَأَصُومَنَّ التَّاسِعِ. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to give me life and I had to see next year Muharram, with the 10th of Muharram, I would fast the 9th of Muharram. With the 10th of Muharram, I would fast an additional day. I would fast the 9th and the 10th. So, we're in a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're in a time. This is the month where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave victory to Musa alayhi salam. He gave victory to Musa alayhi salam over his enemy Fir'aun. Today is the 9th. Tomorrow is the 10th. And brothers and sisters in Islam, it's very important to note that the 10th of Ashura has many rewards and benefits. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in Sahih Muslim, وصيام يوم عاشوراء أحتسب على الله يكفر السنة التي قبله. That to fast the 10th of Muharram, أحتسب على الله, it expiates the sins of the year before it. So one day, Allahu Akbar, one day you fast for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your sins for an entire year are expiated, they're wiped away. One day you do for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sins that you have done for an entire year, they're expiated. But sadly, many Muslims, they look at the 10th of Muharram and they follow the Jews. They follow them, how the Prophet ﷺ says, Al-Qudhati bil-Qudha. They follow them directly. And they wear in the 10th of Muharram or in the month of Muharram, they wear beautiful clothes. They cook delicious food. They fragrance their house. They make a point of going and making salam. 11 months of the year, they don't make salam to people. But when the time of Muharram comes, they go and make salam to people. And they make a point of shaking people's hands. They fragrance their house. And they cook good food. And by doing this, these people follow the practice of the Jews. In Sahih Muslim, the Prophet says that the Jews, they would take the day, the 10th of Muharram, as Eid. They would take it as a day of celebration. They would take it as a day where they show happiness. And this is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to fast the 10th of Muharram, to fast and pray your salah and do the normal worship that you do normally. But for me to cook good food, for me to wear good clothes, and for me to greet one another just because it's Muharram, this is a bid'ah. And bid'ah innovations, they only bring harm to yourselves. They only bring harm to yourselves. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار.